The event took place on approach after a San Francisco to Paris early flight of 11 hours. There are three pilots in the cockpit. The captain was a pilot monitoring, the co-pilot was a pilot flying, and the relief pilot was on a jump seat. The aircraft was stabilized on ILS 25 and configured for landing with autopilot and autothrust engaged. The go-around altitude was set to 2,000 feet as required in parasol. At around 1,400 feet, ZPF disconnected the autopilot. 4 seconds later, the crew were surprised by a predictive wind shear warning. The captain immediately ordered a go-around, which was initiated manually by the co-pilots. This led to an immediate break in the crew action plan and a substantial increase in their workload, which changed the dynamic of the flight. The surprise effect associated with both the predictive wind shear warning and the immediate go-around destabilized the co-pilot, who froze for a short while with symptoms similar to a cognitive incapacitation. After the initiation of the go-around and a nose up input, no further movement was recorded on his side stick, although the autopilot was disconnected. The captain and the relief pilot did not initially detect the co-pilot's absence of reaction. The go-around altitude was exceeded by around 800 feet. Despite the plane's altitude alerts and both the PM and the relief pilot altitude deviation callouts, the flight path also deviated laterally by around 600 meters to the right. At the same time, ATC advised the crew of a possible conflict with the departing airplane. 20 seconds after the altitude alert, the co-pilot finally leveled off at around 2,800 feet. He probably extended the speed brake without any callouts. The captain called IF control and engaged AP1 to follow the missed approach procedure. Although he had identified the flight path deviation, it took him more than 50 seconds after exceeding 2,000 feet to take control of the aircraft. The low energy alert, speed, was triggered due to speed brakes extension. The captain took over manually. He continued the descent and properly pushed the thrust lever to the toga detent in order to increase the aircraft's energy. This caused speed brakes to retract automatically. The captain's workload was very high. He had to manually fly the airplane, monitor the parameters, and keep up with the radio communication, all in a low-speed situation while performing a go-around with the conflicting traffic in the vicinity. After a few seconds, the relief pilot suggested re-engaging the autopilot, which was done by the co-pilot without any callouts. The captain didn't understand why he saw AP2 engaged in vertical speed descent mode. He then engaged AP1 and ordered the others to be silent to allow him to concentrate on the management of the flight. The flight path reached a minimum altitude of 1,500 feet. The captain put the aircraft in climb and then stabilized it at 3,000 feet as cleared by ATC. The co-pilot, who was feeling better, suggested he could act as pilot monitoring for the new approach, which took place without further incidents.
The approach briefing is carried out roughly 30 minutes before landing. Some airports do have complicated missed approach procedures, such as a low go-around altitude and or an immediate turn. Depending on the identified threats at destination, a mini briefing on key points of the go-around procedure during final approach could be helpful to refresh the crew's short-term memory. The use of automation has also proven very effective to follow the go-around procedure accurately. Designing surprise generating scenarios for simulators is extremely challenging. Today, it remains very difficult to surprise crews in their training and assess their individual ability to react and recover from such situations. Therefore, we think that this particular event, replicable in simulators, is a good scenario for operators to include in their training database. An incapacitation may be total and obvious. However, it may also be partial, with the pilot still able to act under controls. In absence of obvious signs, when only cognitive functions are affected, the incapacitation is more difficult to detect. A cognitive incapacitation can have several symptoms, such as incoherent speech, strange behavior, decreased performance, repeated mistakes, as well as no or unexpected responses to requests. When the incapacitation is detected, the aim of the procedure is to follow the Airbus Golden Rules. In case of an incapacitation, in order to avoid interference from the incapacitated flight crew, a pilot can deactivate the other side stick by pressing the side stick push button and take control of the aircraft. It triggers the priority light as well as the oral alert priority left or right and disables the other side stick when pressed for more than 40 seconds. The occurrence of a disruptive element, in this case a predictive windshield warning, triggered a crew decision to carry out a go-around close to a low mist approach altitude of 2,000 feet. This incident is consistent with the conclusions of the BEA AZAGA study, which underlined that a low mist approach altitude with respect to the minima does not give crews sufficient time to carry out a go-around maneuver in good conditions. Although the current go-around procedures is compliant with the applicable requirement, this event and the go-around statistics at Orly led us to issue a safety recommendation to the Air Navigation Services of Paris-Orly in order to study the feasibility of increasing the published mist approach altitude.
Here is a review of our key point today. Surprise effect and cognitive incapacitation in flight are situations which are difficult to handle, but they are adapted procedures to manage their effects. Complex mist approach procedures, such as a low altitude and or an immediate turn, are a threat to be identified and managed. It is important for operators to train their crews to react to a real-life surprise effect during training. Next is the animation of the flight. Thank you and fly safe.
Go around, wind shear ahead.
1,000. speed, speed, speed.